sound to meaning, so that during the wartime when people send messages one to the other, if you don't know the code, you can get the message, but you can't decipher what's in the message. You can't get the meaning. In the same way, language is like a code. If you know only the English code, and you heard a sentence like, I saw the big dog, or however you translate it, you'd hear the words, but you wouldn't be able to put the meaning onto it, because you don't know the rules of Gitksan grammar. Well, again, looking at grammar, there's two sorts of notions we'll see that are important to us now. One is the notion, is the notion of parts of speech. You know, what are the categories, not just the grammatical categories, but what are the word categories of a language? The word categories are parts of speech. And then in just a few minutes, I'll also introduce the notion that you not only have parts of speech in a sentence, but the parts of speech occupy or play different thematic roles, like subject of a sentence, direct object, predicate of a sentence, and so forth. Now, yesterday we went through 12 parts of speech in Somalia, and I pointed out to you that this is a provisional listing. I'm sure that at least this many parts of speech have to be recognized, but it's, you know, it may need to be changed later, or you might want to change some of the labels, like we had that term ambient predicate, of which I explained to you what ambient meant, but you know, it might be better just to call them weather words and time words, or something like that. Now, also yesterday, in defining the parts of speech to you, where I could, I told you something of their usual meanings. In English, in school grammar, you know, you're often taught that a noun is the name of a person, place, or thing, and a verb describes an action or an event. You can find exceptions to those, but in truth, all languages have nouns and verbs, and in truth, for the most part, nouns generally do signify persons, places, and material things, and verbs generally do signify actions and events. But the point is that while you find those sorts of categories in all languages, that the structure of languages, the grammars of languages, are somewhat different. We'll see that particularly, or begin to see it particularly today. But I was saying you need to define parts of speech, not just universally for all languages, but that the parts of speech are specific to particular languages. In English, you can define nouns not only as the words that prototypically or usually signify persons, places, and things, but you know, nouns can be marked for definite or indefinite, like they can take the and a. They have singular and plural forms. They occur with this and that. They have certain structural properties, whereas verbs in English, yes, they typically signify actions and events, but verbs inflect so that you can say bake, bakes, is baking, are baking, did bake, so forth. You can define a verb in terms of how it combines with other words or how it inflects. So similarly in Somalia, we need to get some idea of how the different parts of speech behave with respect to other parts of speech. That helps us to recognize them and to define the separate parts of speech. just on the surface, words like hithu and gigenish and goyim and messiah would just seem to be like nouns, because in English, hithu, morning, is a noun in English, although it means a period of time. Gigenish, the upriver area, that's a noun or a noun phrase in English. Goyim is a noun in English. Messash, daylight, is a noun in English. But we're not describing English grammar. We're trying to be true to the spirit of some Alga grammar, and we'll see that form, like words like hithuk and goyim, messash, they don't behave like other nouns do, or like the general class of nouns in Sipalga, although to some extent they do behave a little bit like nouns. Well, we went on through these 12 parts of speech, and does anybody have any questions at this point? Well, if you don't, let's move on to the second page. And what I'm beginning to say now, again, is very relevant to the task of writing a dictionary. That when you just consider words in isolation, there are many forms or words which sound the same, and when you hear them in isolation, they're ambiguous in meaning. If you just hear the word up, you know, it can have several meanings, and you need to distinguish between these meanings, or more importantly, you need to distinguish between the different parts of speech that a word may belong to. And I've given an example here of this word, or actually we'll see it's really two words. The form that is pronounced as up with a hard back K. If you hear the two sentences up simen, as opposed to bud sakap manit, or bud sakap menit in Western, take the part of something that's left, take the part that remains behind. And if you consider the meaning of up in up simen, and then map it onto English, probably the best way to translate would be something like really, or indeed, or something similar to that. Whereas in gut sakap menit, up there, although it has a sl before it and an hl after it, is a different part of speech. It's a different word. It just happens to be pronounced the same, but in that case, it's a word that means part, to be part of something. Sometimes you could translate it as half, although it's not specifically a half. But in the first sentence, up simen, up is what we'll call a modifier. It belongs to the part of speech that we call modifier. It tells us how the action or state signified is considered or performed. Sometimes up will have the meaning almost like should or ought. You know, you should or you ought to do this. Whereas in the case of gut sakap menit, the up there is a noun, and as we'll see, it's the direct object in the sentence, the direct object in the sentence. Now, let me move on to talk about, not specifically about direct objects, but to define subject and some other notions, and I'll begin to go on to these next three sentences. But give you a bit of a lesson in English grammar to introduce some notions. We won't look at the sentences in Algic at all, but if we take a sentence such as Mary gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon. And to my knowledge, or for my feeling of English grammar, that sentence is absolutely synonymous with, that is, it has exactly the same propositional meaning as Mary gave some half-smoked salmon. To her daughter. This word, ut, that I've used in the Algic there, could actually mean son, too, but I've translated it as daughter. But these two sentences in English, Mary gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon, and as I say, it has exactly the same meaning if you turn these two phrases around. If you take the some half-smoked salmon and put it here, and take the her daughter and put it here, then you have to have a to preposition before it. Now, let's consider these sentences a little bit further. Some of you, this may be familiar to you, but in English grammar, these sentences would be analyzed as containing four major parts, these two sentences. To use the technical term, they'd be analyzed as having four major constituent. Constituent is part of what Aboriginal people in Australia would call that big English, technical English. But constituent means nothing more than part. So, the major parts of the sentence. If we look at, let me move on now. Okay, so the major parts. The sentence, both these sentences have a verb, which I'll symbolize as a V, and the verb of the sentence is a categorical notion. A part of speech. Both sentences have a subject, and I'll write subject like that with an S, or SBJ probably is the best way, a subject. This would be called the indirect object. I'll just write it I-O, but you could write it I-N-D-O-B-J, indirect object. And then some half-smoked salmon is the direct object. Similarly, in Mary gave some half-smoked salmon to her daughter, Mary is the subject, and again, gave is the verb. Some half-smoked salmon remains the indirect object, and to her daughter, the whole thing is an indirect object phrase, but it is introduced by this preposition, to. Again, to tell you something about English grammar, in the usual case, the subject, particularly of a transitive verb, the subject is the person or thing who performs some activity, perform some action that affects something, some particular thing. So, you know, it's Mary who gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon. The verb in the sentence typically signifies, you know, the activity. This is what we'll call a transitive verb, and I'll come back to it later. But it's an activity that has an effect on some object. And the direct object is the thing affected by the action signified by the verb. In other words, it's the half-smoked salmon that got given, was affected by the act of giving, was given. And the indirect object, I know, is the benefactor or receives the benefit of the activity or is in some other way affected by the action described in the verb, the action of the subject in the direct object. So we can break the sentence down into four parts: subject, verb, indirect object, and direct object. In English, it's generally true that any sentence that has a direct object followed by an indirect object phrase, if you say, John sent a book to his son, subject, verb, direct object, indirect object. You can also say, John sent his son a book, if they mean the same thing. Those are rules of English grammar. And the reason why I'm going over this is to introduce notions like subject, verb, direct object, and indirect object, because we're going to see similar things in Sapalga, and you need to have the concepts. The notion of subject and indirect object and direct object, these are not parts of speech, but they are thematic roles, or functions is another way of thinking about it. The subject of a sentence in English is prototypically, you know, the agent or the performer of an action. The direct object is prototypically the thing that gets affected by the action signified in the verb, and the indirect object, you can define it as being further affected by the action. Actually, viewing the sentence strictly in terms of thematic roles, there's another way of looking at it, in which the sentence just has two parts. It consists of a subject and a predicate. Subject and a predicate. Subject and a predicate. That gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon, or gave some half-smoked salmon to her daughter, those are a single part of speech. A single constituent of the sentence as a single thematic role, what's called the predicate. You know, this is a sentence, this sentence is about Mary. Mary is the subject and the performer of the action. The predicate tells you, a predicate simply is something which tells you something about something. In this case, the gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon predicates some information about Mary. Some information about Mary. So, English grammar, if you study it in school, you learn something about the rules of English grammar, that the subject always comes at the beginning before the verb in most sentences, that the direct object comes typically after the verb, that if the direct object precedes the indirect object has a to preposition, but if the indirect object comes first, you don't say Mary gave to her daughter some half-smoked salmon. It has meaning, but it's not really quite the right way to say it. Now, let's move to these sentences in Sapalga. If you've got this copy down good, if you haven't followed me completely, or if it doesn't make complete sense, don't worry, because I'll be coming fact. But you see, in doing grammar of any language, when we look at sentences, we not only want to be able to say what part of speech a particular word belongs to, but we want also to see what thematic role the word is playing, or maybe the word is part of a larger phrase like to her daughter, which is playing the role of indirect object. Yes. In English. The order, they can occur in either order, but if the indirect object follows the direct object, it has to have the two prepositions.
So the first sentence isn't one grammatical.
Pardon?
The first sentence isn't one grammatical.
No, the first sentence is good English, good standard English, and non-standard too. And these two sentences, I say, to use a technical term, are synonymous. That means they mean the same thing. It's just two different ways of saying the same thing. For some people, one might be more formal than the other. You might say one but write the other. To come back to the point, you want to be able to break a sentence down into its words to determine what part of speech each word belongs to, and then what are the thematic roles in the sentence, you know, like the subject and the verb. You know, what's the predicate in a sentence? And we'll see in Sabalga, we really won't have subjects like English. There's something else very similar to English subjects. We'll have predicates and we'll have verbs, so forth. But let's try to take these concepts now and look at these sentences in Somalia. I hope I haven't made any mistakes in these. Dennis, Mary. Good. Okay, the daughter, as you point out, Scoosh from Hanak, but let me just say, gave her child. So I don't have to write it in the longer one on the board, and in return for that, I'll write it in Western. S. L. Yeah. Heart. Elgi, even. I'll make it quite clearly past. It's removed. Guinness, Mary, Spust, Estel, Elgi. Translate that as Mary gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon. And what I want to look at, just right now and briefly, not completely justified, what we have the word tell. And I think we should be able to agree that this sentence translates as Mary gave to her daughter, or Mary gave her daughter some half-smoked salmon. It's marked differently from English. Don't worry about the English. The English translation is true, is correct, but it doesn't follow the Somali grammar, you know, word for word or phrase by phrase. But what I'm trying to get here is, we look at this word tell, in this case, it's a noun. It's signifying a thing, half-smoked salmon, and also we'll see that it is in Somali grammar, it's what I would call an indirect object or an oblique phrase. Perhaps a slightly more accurate translation would be something like, Mary provided her child with half-smoked salmon. But where you use gin in the sense of provide, that it means provide food. You can't provide, you can't gain wood unless, of course, somebody eats it. You can't gain paper. You get numb paper or wood. But gain is, so that perhaps the truer translation would be Mary provided her child with L. Okay, now let's look at the next sentence, which also has L in it, but I want to make the point here that L is not the same part of speech as it is up there. L's Mary. And to not put too much into it, it would translate simply as, or one way of translating is, Mary is slicing up. You know, Mary is, or to put it in English, Mary is telling. Mary is telling would be probably the truest translation. There's no direct reference to half-smoked salmon except in that word tell. And in this case, the youk part tells us that the activity is going on. The subject of the sentence, the person who is doing the telling, is Mary. And we know that Mary is a proper noun because it has the S connective. If I wanted to say the woman is telling, I would say youk tells hanuk. But because Mary is a personal name, I have to use the S connective. But the point I'm making here is that tal is not a noun, but it's an intransitive verb of V-I is the abbreviation we use. And as an intransitive verb, it tells us something about an action that's not done to a particular person or thing. On the other hand, if we take this sentence here, dim Alice, Mary, honest, or honest, spell it how you would like, Mary will slice up the fish, and I put in parentheses into thin strips for smoking. The dim tells us it's future tense. Again, we have Mary as our subject, and we have hun or hun as our object. You know, Mary is telling the hun. You know, Mary is the subject. Tell is a transitive verb here, a VT. This is the direct object right here. It, the whom receives, you know, it's the thing that's affected by Mary's telling, you know, slicing up. So that in these three sentences, we have the word or form, L, but they belong to different parts of speech, and those different parts of speech are playing different thematic roles in the sentence.
Why is the added to the end of the word?
You could leave it out there, but the ist right here means something like here and now, and it's typically used, you know, if you're talking to somebody that you're on a good, friendly, informal relationship with. But you can tell that this E right here, see, notice there's no E there. It's just, you can't say you tell us Mary. It's ungrammatical. Similarly, I can't say dim tells Mary hoonest. The E right here actually is a little suffix that tells us that the verb is transitive. Now, I'm just telling you that right now. As we go along, we'll begin to see. But what I'm trying to do is to break these sentences down. We can, I think, for the most part, agree what the words are. and they belong to different parts of speech. And they, as different parts of speech in sentences, they play different thematic roles.
Is that the same as the gi on self?
The gi and the ist occur there in what the linguists would call contrastive distribution. This means remote in space and time. Remote in space and time, or space and or time. So when you talk about simogat lahagi, as opposed to just simogat laha, the simogat lahagi, simogat lahagi, the gi at the end gives, adds a little bit of meaning that is removed, perhaps not visible. The ist right here, as in honest, indicates that it's present in the situation. It doesn't mean quite like this, but it means it's present in the situation, not necessarily definite. And that it has other meanings too. By the way, getting the meanings of things like these little suffixes is very difficult, and it takes a long time, and I'm not absolutely sure about them. Okay, take my word for it, then we have tau, which, you know, there's a common meaning through all of these. You know, tau in this case is the material thing, you know, it's what Mary gave to her daughter, it's half-smoked salmon. In here, as in you, tau's Mary, tau is the intransitive verb that means to perform the activity that produces tell, but it doesn't tell you that it's with respect to any particular fish, so it just means to perform that activity. Whereas the tell here, as in dim tellus Mary Hennis, it too, it's not the salmon itself, it's not the half-smoked salmon, it means to perform the cutting up or slicing up activity on a particular fish, or on a fish that's mentioned, that'll result in it becoming
Okay,
so we could just substitute fillet. Do you spell fillet with one L or two?
Two.
Okay. Yeah. So you could translate the second sentence as Mary is filleting. It's not Mary is filleting fish, except in where the fish is understood. See, the sentence doesn't say fish. There's no word for fish in Yuk-Sal's Mary. You just understand it because you know that when you sell, you do it to fish. And then the third sentence would be, Mary will fillet the fish. And you know, you understand it's into the thin strips that you smoke. Okay, well, what I'd like to do now is to move on. I've used these terms like...
Go on, Bruce. They do tell meat.
Good. That's something that I've been under the, you know, you're helping me correct my knowledge, because I just thought it was always for fish. I know, that's why I'm glad. That's why I say I'm learning as much as I'm teaching in this class.
Verify it. We do exist.
Good. So that what it does is it, you typically sell fish, but you can sell other things, but it's filleting, cut into thin strips. Well, I'd like to move on, and this distinction between transitive and intransitive verb is what I want to have a go at now with you. It is extremely important in semiology, because depending on whether a verb is transitive or intransitive, you choose different pronouns, you know, to put it into a sentence. The way transitive verbs fit into sentences is completely different than the way that intransitive verbs fit into sentences. Basically, with the intransitive verbs, you use the nit set of pronouns with the transitive for the subject. For the intransitive verbs, for the transitive verbs, you use the suffixes hard y, n, and t. Well, let's look on down here. And by the way, there's a mistake. The sentence that's in Sipalga is "Limch Barbara." Means Barbara sang, not Barbara danced. That's just my mistake in typing. But these next three sentences illustrate intransitive verbs. And we have York, adus, the cat ate, limched to Barbara, and gibbas Bruce. The cat ate, Barbara sang, Bruce waited. While in English, the cat ate, the sentence can be broken down into, it has a subject and a verb, just a simple predicate. And Barbara sang. Barbara is the subject, sang is the verb. Bruce waited. Bruce is the subject, Bruce is the verb. These are intransitive verbs, ate, sang, and waited. They simply, when you use an intransitive verb, or when you have a sentence with an intransitive verb, the sentence tells you what the action is and who or what performs the action, namely the subject. If I use yolk with goose, I can't say yolkish goose smash or yolkish goose home. Doesn't make sense, not grammatical. That's because the verb yolk is an intransitive verb. It takes only a subject. It tells you, you have to have a noun or a pronoun with it that tells you who does the yolking, but you can't say what it is that gets yolk there to translate into English. On the other hand, with transitive verbs, the complete sentence should tell you who, what the action is, who does it or what does it, and who gets done to or what gets done to. So we have gubish, doos, a cup, home. And we look at it in English. Sentence translates into the cat ate the piece of fish. The cat ate the piece of fish. It analyzes into a subject plus a predicate. The cat is the subject and ate the piece of fish is the predicate. We can analyze it further into the cat as the subject and then ate is the verb and the piece of fish is the direct object. And you see it to be a complete, or in a sentence with a transitive verb, it not only tells you who performed the action, but it tells you that the action affected some particular thing or person, you know, and that's actually mentioned in the sentence. Similarly, we can take these notions and look at them in Sipalga, And I can tell you that we have a predicate in the sentence, which in this case will be the gubish. And then we have a transitive subject. I'll just call it that, a transitive subject. It's different from English. It's the deuce that did the gooping. And what is it that got gooped? The sub-op's home. Now, notice we can't say Yorkwish deuce sub-op's home. We can't say goops deuce in the sense of the cat is eating. We can say goops. No, we can't say goops deuce except it means eat the cat. You eat the cat, right. It's a, if what, you can have that sentence, but it doesn't mean what you would expect there. See, what I'm getting at is the distinction between these two kinds of verbs in between transitive and intransitive verbs is extremely important. And quite often the transitive and intransitive verbs look completely different. They are in a suppletive relationship. Although we'll see later on, if you take a verb like a word like soul, to skin, you can say dim soho di, I will skin it. You can say soho toots, the bird got skinned, or I could say soho shni, I did some skinning, where you use the same verb transitively and intransitively with different meanings. But quite often, similar meanings, but you have different words for transitive, different for intransitive. So we have a predicate here, subject, and a direct object. Let's move down to the next sentence. Quashen limk yedis Barbara. Barbara sang an old song. This is actually a focused sentence. Probably the best translation is something like, it was an old song that Barbara sang. But we'll just translate it as Barbara sang an old song. But if we break it down, it has a verb, the yedis. It has a transitive subject. You know, who did the singing? It was Barbara. Put TS there for transitive subject. And what was it that Barbara sang? Quashen limsh. An old song there. Or we have the direct object. But you notice with this verb yetdis, I can't, if I say yetdis Barbara, it would be okay. I mean, but it's like Barbara sang it. I couldn't just come out with that sentence, you know, I couldn't say, I'm a Hesu yedis Barbara. You might say, well, what the hell did Barbara sing? In the equivalent in Somalia, because you see, it has an understood pronoun there. What I'm getting at is verbs like yedis, in the usual case, you have to say, who did the singing and what was sung? Similarly, Gibias Bruce Barbara, if I use the verb Gibah, I have to not only say who did the waiting, but who got waited for. With these transitive verbs, you have to indicate both the subject and the object. You know, who did the action and who got affected by the action, who was waited for. and in this case, it'd be Gibias Bruce to Barbara. I could say Gibias Bruce, and it's a good sentence, but again, it means, you know, Bruce waited for him, Bruce waited for her, maybe Bruce waited for them, but you wouldn't use it at the beginning of a conversation. You wouldn't use it until you had indicated you were talking about some specific person. But the point is that verbs like goop, yeti, and giba are transitive verbs, and they require you to say not only who did something, but who got done to. Who got done to. Notice I could not say gibeish gibeish to Bruce to Barbara. But I couldn't say gibeish to Bruce to Barbara. Doesn't make sense. I can say gibeish to Bruce. Bruce waited. Doesn't say who Bruce was waiting for. If I wanted to say he was waiting for Barbara, I could say this. And notice then that I have to use the S there. Gibe S. Bruce S. Barbara. And that translates into English as Bruce waited for Barbara. But let me ask you now before I move on, I think there's a slight difference of meaning between Gibias Bruce to Barbara and Gibias Bruce S. Barbara. And would the difference be in this one, essentially, I was focused on waiting for her. Whereas, in my kind of English, I'd say, Bruce waited for Barbara. But I have another way, I'd say, Bruce waited on Barbara. And I might have been whistling or reading at the same time.
When we use the two, that talk, like your face, it's almost like now.
Mm-hmm.
But if you told everybody that you waited, it's almost like the past.
Okay. So the situations may be appropriate both the past and present, but I'm thinking there might be something a bit more that in this case, you know, I was waiting on her, but I might have been doing something else at the same time. My activity with my whole thought and everything was not focused on waiting for her. So that in English, my kind of English, I'd say, I waited on Barbara. Doesn't mean I served her, you know, it's not like to wait on somebody in a restaurant. But in my kind of English, which may be different from yours up here, to wait on somebody is different from to wait for somebody. To wait for somebody, you know, you're there and, you know, why the hell doesn't she come? She's late. Whereas waiting on somebody, you know, I'm doing something else and I could care less. But that's incidental to what we're talking about now. What I've tried to get across to you is that transitive and intransitive verbs exist not only in English, but you have them in some algic, and they fit into sentences in a different way. That the intransitive verbs, when you put them into a sentence, you have to say who performs the action, and you don't have to say who gets affected by it. And in the case of gibeish, when you do say who gets affected by it, you would do it with an S or an us or an ash or an ash phrase. Yeah, not with an object, but with an indirect object phrase. Whereas with an intransitive verb, just put it into the sentence, and all you have to do is put the subject there. Any questions? Yes, Joan.
One question. You talked about the distinction between the two words. I think in the second case, it would be an answer that you would give if someone waiting for Barbara or not.
That's a good point, and we'll see in the material that I'm beginning to present to you, I'm going to be simplifying a fair bit, simplifying my sentences in order to build up some background and some concepts. That's sort of simplifying in order to analyze and to understand things is a very typical strategy in doing science or the sort of intellectual activity. And the point that you raise is that the one seems to be more appropriate as an answer to a question. That is something that I'll bring up later. In fact, I found as I was trying to learn the language, and it took me some years to realize this, that I couldn't look at sentences in isolation, but I had to look at how they relate to others. And just as there's a way of forming questions in English, there, and there's a way of forming questions in Sualgic, the way you answer a question in Sualgic is quite different than from in English. And I want to try to build up to that. But I'm glad you raised the point now because it alerts us to that.
Why is there a T in front of Barbara?
Here?
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, if you were saying, would you just say, Gibias, Bruce, Barbara? Or would you have a T in there? Gibias, Bruce. You wouldn't say Gibias, Bruce, Barbara, would you? Do any of you not have the T here? Okay. Well, what the T is here, maybe I'll answer your question. So the T tells you that Barbara is one person and that Barbara is a proper name. See, if I say Bruce waited for the child, I would say Gibias Bruce Keith, or Keith is a common noun, so you use the th connected. But because I've used a proper noun here, and Barbara is singular, I have to use T. But if I didn't just wait for Barbara, but I waited for Barbara and her mates, to use a strain there, I could say, Gibias Bruce Dip Barbara, where the dip, you see, tells me that it's people, it's proper names, but it's plural. And we all know about them, Barbara.
Bruce's own.
Yeah, that's right. She is Bruce's own. Although she'd dispute that, she might say, I'm Barbara's own. Okay, well, I'd like to, well, just a bit more. This distinction, not to try to teach more, but this distinction between transitive and intransitive verbs is extremely important in learning the language if you're a second language learner. If you're teaching the language to kids, it's important because, you know, the difference between transitive and intransitive verbs is extremely important, and if the kids already know English, quite often the transitive and intransitive verbs in English look alike. We can say John ate the bread. You can use the same verb, eat, both transitively and intransitively, whereas in Sualgic we've got two intransitives for to eat. We have yol, or singular, to eat something where you don't say what it is. It's paired up with talk, or talk, plural. We have the transitive goop, which means to eat one thing, but if you gip goop, you eat different several things or several different kinds of things. And if you eat some indefinite thing, as you know, you eat. is, you eat sapbaris, or smash, you eat meat. And actually, there's another kind of eating which is very specialized, but how many of you ever indulge in gubas?
Gubas.
Okay? Gubas. You know where you
eat
the berries while you're picking. As Pearl Trombley described it to me, it's like grazing at your leisure. But you see, the gubas has the goop in it, but I can't say gubas is my. I'd have to say gubas ni es mai, perhaps. I grazed leisurely on berries. So gubas has a transitive verb stem in it, but by adding this right here, it makes it into an intransitive verb. Well, I think rather than move on into new material, I've probably done enough. I've probably put enough into your brains this morning. You're going into grammar overload if we do more. But tomorrow I will move on to talk about declarative sentences, question sentences, and imperative sentences are directive, you know, sentences you use to get somebody to do something. I'll introduce those notions. And over the next few days, we'll be looking at different kinds of declarative sentences, whether they're independent sentences or whether they're complex, you know, where you have sentences within sentences. And just to anticipate, the grammar of the syntax, the part that we're getting into now, is very different from English. People in the past, when I first started learning the language, they would often say to me, our language is backward. Mm-hmm. You know, we talk backward from English, you know, because you put the verb at the beginning, followed by the subject, followed by the object. Well, it's true that in that sense, you know, the verb in English comes in the middle, it comes at the front in Somalgish usually. But I wouldn't want you to think that the grammar isn't regular. It is. And there are other languages in the world that have somewhat similar types of grammar. You know, in one sense it's unique. In another sense there's nothing in it that you don't find somewhere else in some other language. And again, simply tells us something about human beings that in some ways we're all alike, in other ways we're slightly different, but we make use of the same kind of hard wiring, and we make use of much the same kind of software programming upstairs when it comes to language. Right. Specifically, what I'd like to do is to start talking about the languages of the region, specifically the languages that border on the Gitksan homeland, or that in other ways are important to, have been important to Gitksan people because the old people intermarried with them, or traded with them, or had common ceremonies and so forth. And I'll start essentially right here with the language that's called Babine. The people generally, or the specific people closest by, are the Wet'suwet'en. And in their own language, the way that word is spelt now, you can either W-I-T-S-U or W-I-T-S-O, either way is okay. And they pronounce the name Wet'suwet'en, Wet'suwet'en, Wet'suwet'en. It's almost like this is a long E there, Wet'suwet'en. And it's a hard T. Now, I know the way it's written in English like this, you would think that that's a hard T or hard TS there, but it's not. It's just, this is just an English spelling that somehow caught on. But the spelling that's actually used in the language now is this. But this is the language which is closest to the Gitksan homeland, borders on it, and as you know, many of the people are intermarried. They're your relations and people that you often feast with, visiting back and forth. And that language belongs to a very widespread family of languages called Athabaskan. Athabaskan. And I'd like to talk about the Athabaskan languages now more broadly before I come back to Wet'suwet'en and Sekene and Dine and these other Athabaskan languages that are important. The Athabaskan language family includes languages that are found in both America and Canada, and not just the lower 48 states, but also in Alaska, in the 49th or 50th, 49th state, I guess, Alaska was. So if you look at where Athabaskan languages are found, they're really quite widespread. We're located right in here, and there is a great number, a dozen or so, Athabaskan languages that are spoken in this area here, Alaska, northern British Columbia, and the Yukon Territory, and actually out into the Northwest Territories, Athabaskan languages. I put just a few names down, like Pakna and Wichin. Jim Carey, who some of you have met, who's done work on the Wet'suwet'en language, is at the Alaska Native Language Center in Alaska, and he makes a specialty of Alaskan Athabaskan languages. That's what occupies most of his hours today. But Athabaskan languages are also found in other places, all as far away from this area and from Alaska as Arizona and New Mexico. Arizona and New Mexico, where you have the Navajo people, and Navajo is the indigenous North American language that has the greatest number of speakers, probably 120,000 or so speakers. But it too is having trouble losing children to English, so that they're trying to strengthen their situation.
The language that Jim is working with, is it similar to the Wet'suwet'en?
Mm-hmm.
Quite similar.
Yeah. These Athabaskan languages are very similar to each other. They are sort of like French and Spanish and Italian and Portuguese and Romanian, you know, which are all daughter languages of Latin that are fairly similar, are like Norwegian, Swedish, Danish, you know. They're really quite similar. And in fact, Jim, when he did his PhD in New Mexico, I was his main supervisor, he actually studied the Navajo language for about 3 years, and then he moved to Alaska and started working on these.
And then is the Navajo similar to the...
Yeah, Navajo has words in it like "ki" that means dog. Navajo has the word "debe" that means sheep. Apache, Western and Eastern Apache, have those same words. So it's a very widespread family of languages where they're separate languages. The Navajos and the Eastern and Western Apaches can't understand each other. It's like, you know, Tsimshian and our Somaliyuk, but they obviously are very close. So you've got Athabaskan-speaking peoples, you know, heaps of them in Alaska and northern British Columbia, north from here, all the way down in Arizona and New Mexico. And then there are other Athabaskans found all the way down in California, in the redwood forest, people call the hoopa. And you go into southwestern Oregon, there are people, the tututne, or tolowa. And here at the mouth of the Columbia River, not right on the river and on the coast where the Chinook people live, but in the hills behind them were people called Qualhiaqua, they talk an Athabascan language. They're all, their language is extinct now, but they lived right here. And I'm not sure exactly where it is, but down in the Nicola Valley in southern B.C., near Merritt, and what other Indian nation lives down there? Well, there was, in the last century, a group of people living in the Nicola Valley who talked an Athabascan language called Nicola, but they gave it away and came to speak the local, the Shuswap or one of the other languages there. And so you see, they're really quite widespread, these Athabascan languages. There are, what, about 25 or so different Athabascan languages, at least that, you know, spoken all the way from Alaska to the southwest, and on, you know, out on the Pacific coast. And, you know, it's an interesting question, you know, how did they get there? You know, did they start out in Arizona and New Mexico and people shifted north, or did they start in Alaska and go south, or did they start here and some moved north, some moved south and so forth? Can't really answer that question just now. But if we look now at the Athabascan languages in the area that were important to the old people here, because they often knew them, traded with them, married with them, and sometimes fought with them, we find that the people had names for them. Now, the first Athabascan language I want to talk about is the one that in the linguistic literature, Jim Carey and Sharon Hargis call Babine. Babine, just that's its technical name, but it's the language spoken by the Wet'suwet'en people. It's also spoken at, you know, Hagelgut and Morristown and at Babine Lake. And it's a different, it sometimes is called Carrier, but it isn't Carrier. The old Father Maurice knew that, but people didn't listen to him, didn't listen to others. Carrier, the language spoken over at Burns Lake and, you know, farther to the south and so forth, is quite different from the Hagelgut Morristown Babine Lake language. It's as different as, well, it's not like Gitksan and Tsimshian. It would be, you know, even more distant, this Babine language and these Carrier languages.
Most of the Babine people are living very safely.
And not only have their own language, many of them talk that Burns Lake language too, I understand.
I always thought it was the same. Some people say it's similar.
They're similar because they're both Athabascan, but they are different.
Further away, it gets faster.
Yeah. Yeah. The further away you get, the more it changes.
Just like the dog,
Now, the name that I've learned for this Babine language, and I'd like to ask about it. Some of you, I may be mistaken, but I've heard it called Silmamach. Silmamach. Now, for me as a linguist looking at that word, it suggests something to me. you know, the mach at the end, as in Gitksan mach or Amksiwa mach, the mach at the end must be language, you know, the part that means language. The sil part, we know, like in silget, silanak, means like companion or mate. What's the ma right here? What's the ma mean? Now, if we take two other words and look how they behave, if you take nach for snowshoe, how many of you would say nanach for snowshoes? And noch, your mother, and mothers would be nonach. So that mamach looks almost like it's a plural. It means languages. I'm just speculating and asking what you think, particularly some of the older people here. So that really something of the meaning of this might be companion languages, or languages that are mates, you know, that it's a recognition by the old Gitksan people that these Athabaskan languages are very similar to each other.
Wouldn't you say that the Gitksan people gave them that's the name they gave the language, Sumama?
Yeah, this is our word.
Yeah.
And it's not their word, they have their own. And what I'm trying to do here is to see if we can break this down and analyze it a bit. But Silmamach, and just think about it and ask people, is it just one language or is it more than one?
I was trying to say that. So,
yeah. Well, if you did that, then it's definitely plural, eh? Pasul mama would be. Okay, so that would mean they talk different languages, or they talk related languages. Yeah. Okay, so that's an interesting name, and maybe we can tell something about history, so forth, by studying its meaning. Further afield, Burns Lake, Decker Lake, and going south, you get other varieties of what's called carrier, and I don't know their names, but there's another Athabaskan language that was adjacent to the Gitksan homeland around Bear Lake, and that's the language called Secony in English. I don't know its name in Somalia. How? Sikini. That would be like this then. Sikini. And you put an accent. Well, no, you don't need an accent there. Sikini. Sikini. Good. That's new to me. And I've talked with Neil about this and lots of other old people to try to find out what... I'm actually being respectful. Well, you're a knowledgeable person. But trying to find out what the old Somalic name for Bear Lake was.
Well, it must be smach of some kind, because Mary Smach. Alice, was Mary, did she come by the name of Smach before she left Hazelden? Mary Smach, you know her.
Is that Mary Robinson? Mary Fanny?
No, her name is Mary Smythe. That's
oh, Marion. Marion.
Marion,
yeah.
Is it? Well, was her name Smythe before she left Hazelden?
I think so, yeah.
But I think there was... There must have been something about a bear, because on the other tributaries, the Sestoot is the Bear Wallow Lake, Bear Wallow River.
Yeah.
So
names like that, Sestoot.
Well, Sestoot.
The Sus there, Sus in those Athabascan languages is usually the word for bear.
The word Sestoot didn't come until after 1907, because I've got a map with that. It's Bear Lake, Bear Lake, Bear River to the Skeena. No Sestoot then.
But the Sus part of it...
It's an official map.
The Sus part of it is not from Spalgach, but it's the Athabascan word for bear, whereas our word is smash or smush. Okay, so the Sikini have their own Athabascan language. There are people at Bear Lake are from there who understand top Somalia as well as Sikini, and sometimes the Babine language. There are other people who in English are called Tahltan, who are a bit further afield, but again, they border the northernmost Gitksan homeland. And in English, they're called Tahltan, but the name that I was taught some years ago is Dahtan, and they have their own language. It's an Athabascan language, Dahtan. How do you say it? Same?
Dash-dan.
Okay. Maybe with just a short vowel there, rather than a long vowel. And I would expect some of these names to be pronounced a little bit different. Then the next Athabascan people, who again border on the Gitksan homeland, are called Stikeen in English, which is pretty close to what they're called in Somalia, except that it has a hard K, Stikeen. 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 Again, they border on the Gitksan homeland, and actually I wish I had a map of the homeland here, because it would help us see more clearly in our minds where they're located. And then there's another group of Athabascan-speaking people who in English, their name is spelled this way and is pronounced in English as Tsetsaut. And these are the people who are called, the way I learned it, is Jitsawit. 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 And it might be that this Tsao part here has to do something like the interior country, you know, the interior country, people from the interior country. But they were, you know, in the new bordering on the northern part of the Gitksan homeland, and if you read the histories, laws, and territories of the Kitlin Kool, the book that Mrs. Cox helped to translate and write down, the old Kitlin Kool Simbigat talk a lot about how they fought with the Jitsawit in the past over trade and so forth. They're actually, and there's nobody who talks that language anymore, that Jitsawit language. It's all gone. They're actually, from what I've been able to make out from my work, or at least two different Jitsawit groups. There's a group who live further in the interior around a place which in our language we call Lachwiyip, on the Big Prairie. Lachwiyip, or the Kit Lachwiyip. And there was another group of those Jitsawit who, about 1880 were living over around Portland Canal in the Alaskan Panhandle, not too far from Kinkola. And they were called, and the Sky people called them Jitsawit, but they also called them the Gitsiyaik. Siyaik was the area around Portland Canal. And there were not very many of them, and they came in when, wasn't Tomlinson, who was the missionary, one of the early missionaries at Kinkolas? Could have been Tomlinson, actually. Yeah, I think he was the first main. But they came in and lived there and attached themselves to Chief Mountain, and gave up their own language, intermarried to some extent with the Niskaya, but still remained separate. And there's still some of those families around. Their English name is Dangeli. But there was an old man, Levi Dangeli, and younger man, and so forth. But they were originally not Niskaya. They were Gitsiyaik, Jitsawit. And Boaz, whom I've mentioned to you before, when he spent a couple of weeks at Kinkolas in 1892, I think it was, 100 years ago. He worked with these surviving people, and he wrote down a couple of hundred words of their language. It's very different from other Athabascan languages. Like I was saying, around here, most of the languages around here, Athabascan, the word for bear is sus or shush, something like that. In the Tsawit language around Portland Canal and so forth, the word for bear is fu, F-U, but not fu, it's where you use both the fu. And if you go to Gitwinksik, Canyon City, the people who live there will tell you long ago the Jitsawit used to live around here, and their word for bear is fu. So I don't know why it is, but the Canyon City people have remembered that word from that now extinct language, and they tell it to people. But these languages are interesting for us here because there's been a lot of borrowing of words. We've borrowed some words from them, and they've borrowed words from Somalia. I couldn't give you its English name. No, I've seen it on the map and so forth. Where the Big Prairie is located. Its name in English is not Big Prairie. It has another name, I think. I couldn't even tell you that simply. I don't remember. But as I was saying, there's obviously the Gitksan people have been in contact over a very long period of time with some of these Athabascan languages. And there are...
See that segment? When we get dressed in Christmas, that's what we do. We act like the segment. The lucky bomb get them down.
Really?
Yeah. Tigidat.
Tigidat from Washington State, actually. Over amongst the Niskai, I forget which tribes, which clans do which, but some of them dress up as Milwa, man of war, others as Zain, and others as Niggin, and you know do their but the reason reason why I've spent the time talking about these Athabascan languages, I mentioned the other day that this word debah for mountain sheep is a word that we're pretty sure was borrowed into Sipalga, and in Nispah, and some Gitksan people pronounce it as Dawi or even Dawe, which must come from a different language. The word for moose, Chadai, again is pretty plainly from Athabascan. Widzish, caribou, is Athabascan. Ach, a word that, you know, is quite squarely, I mean, it's a very old word, but it's found in all the Athabascan languages. I mean, even Navajo has the word ka for rabbit there. And, you know, other words like na-fates, dakaluts, gindishi, and so forth. And one other word that is fully symbolic in its root and suffix, but it illustrates a pattern that's found in virtually all the Athabascan languages. What do you call this, the calf of your leg? How?
Honey.
Honey. Honey. Stop and think about honey. Why is it called honey? You know, the E at the end, you know, with the giteni, you know, it's like tennis. The E at the end of it means sort of like English-ish. But what's a horn? What's a horn? It's a fish, a salmon. Although normally we don't say horn, that's the Nispah way, we say hoon or hun. But it describes how the calf, you know, looks, has the general shape of a fish. And that's found in all the Athabascan languages where the word for calf will mean something like a fish. And in Sipalga, you use indigenous Sipalga material, you know, the root hon and the suffix e, but it's an Athabascan type construction. It's also found in Europe, I think, in Sami and some of the certain polar languages. The other thing to ask is what kind of words did they borrow from us? And as you know, it's a lot of personal names and names having to do with the feasts, with the feasting system and so forth. So these are the Athabascan languages of the area, and they're extremely important to know something about them in learning something about the language history of Sipalga. Let me move on to the next language that's in the region that doesn't really border on the Gitksan homeland, but nevertheless our people had contact with them, and sometimes intermarried, but more often I think took them as something else. These are the people who are called Tlingit, and their territory stretches all the way from Tongass. Tongass in here, right on up to around Yakutat Bay, as I recall, up along the Alaskan Panhandle. And the Tlingit language, you know, in that area is pretty similar all the way. There's not really marked different. You know, there's not a lot of dialect diversity in it.
On the Queen Charlotte's, is that what they speak on the Queen Charlotte's?
No, Haida. Another language. I'll get to it in a minute. But Tlingit, the Tlingit language, and there are some words that have been borrowed from the Tlingit language into both the Gitksan and also into the Tsimshian and Nisqa Sipavgih. In their language, the word for get or people is Lingit. Lingit. In our language, as you know, that same word, Tlingit. What are Tlingit? One, a male cha, female batu, and plural Tlingit. What's the meaning of Tlingit? Or if you talk, sometimes their grandfathers used to call a boy, Skuthingit, mean, slaves, the plural. So that, see, the Tlingit, as in Skuthingit, is singular, but Tlingit, plural, slaves. Why would our old people here have borrowed that word? You know, it means people for them. Over here, it means slaves. Why might they have done that? Just think about it. It's their word originally. I think the reason's fairly obvious because, you know, numbers of them were taken in the old days as slaves. Similarly, the word this word in our Sipalgah, Gawagani. Longi, Gawagani, Gawagani. I think I've heard Mrs. Ryan use have a long I at the end there. And what does that mean to the older people? Gex, peace, or specifically in the old days, it was the peacemaking ceremony that people went through. And in the Tlingit language, the word Gawakan, I think it is, means deer, when or one, but what it refers to are the hostages who were exchanged in the old days to make peace. So you see, the old people here borrowed that Tlingit word not to mean deer, but for hostages, and it came to mean peacemaking ceremony. Similarly, another word that comes from the Tlingit language, which is extremely important here, is sak, which are oolikins, but not just any oolikins. Most specifically are the par excellence or the oolikins from the lower Nass, from around Kincolith and north of there, sak. And that word is found, you know, in all the Tlingit dialects, and it's also found in Niskaam and in Gitksanam, that sack. And you might ask, well, how does he know, or how do I know that it's Tlingit and not Sipalgah? You know, it wasn't borrowed the other way. Well, for one thing, there are all history stories that talk about, that the Niskaya tell about how they acquired that territory and took it from the Tlingit in the old days. But there is a word, an old word in Sipalgah that means oolikin, that's similar. If any of you know the coast language, the word for oolikin is not just sack, but I have a little difficulty pronouncing it. It's something like, some of the old people may know this. When you se'uyash, se'uyash.
What? This is Ryan just saying you said what?
How? What? It's a very old word, and another way, there's this word se'uyash, which means to make ulik in Greece, and where this u part here is, I think, related to that tsimsan way. The other little thing I want to tell you about Tlingit before we leave is Nast River. The river itself, the Niska people call, in their language, Xilisims, where the Xi is the same as our Xi, you know, means river or stream, Xilisims. And our old people over here called it Xitamsim. But in English, it's called Nass River. And I wondered for a long time, where does that word Nass come from? Because it's not a word in some Algic. And I've just recently found out that the Tlingit name for the Nass River is Nass, which is like English N-A-S-S, Nass. Now, in our Algic, when you say the people of such and such place, we would say Gitnas, the people of the Nass. In the Tlingit language, the way you say, put it like this, the way you say the people of the Nass, instead of saying Gitnas, they say Nas'a. And, of course, what do the Niskak call themselves? Niskak, which probably then is the name they call themselves has its origin not in their own language, but has its origin in Tlingit, which is probably the explanation for that is that the lower Nass territories are territories that they shifted into and, you know, simply continued on with the same ethnic group name. Okay, moving on. So Tlingit, you see, is Joan. It's just the name of the river. It's like Sun, well, that's from CN maybe, but it's just the name of the Nass River. People of the Nass.
In Telegraph Creek, artists up there claim to be Tlingit artists.
Yeah. Well, the Tlingit moved into the interior in the last century.
Yeah. A lot of them are Bear Lake, and some of them claim to be Tlingit. Mm. Yeah. I thought the Tlingits were all just on the Linkish River.
No. Okay, well, the next language I want to... next language I want to mention that's of interest, again, doesn't border on the Gitksan homeland, but again, its people were important here. And that's the language that was spoken out in the Queen Charlotte Islands, which in English is called Haida. Haida. But in our Sephardic way, it's called Haida. Haida. And it's important because there was intermarriage in the old days, and some people here spent time there in the past. They have, you know, some common history. And as well, there was a lot of trade in the old days, and a certain amount of intermarriage. And there's a few words from the Haida language that have been borrowed into Sinhala that are interesting. There's this word for fur seal that generally don't come in too close to the mainland coast, probably further out, but con. And if you know Niskam, you know that con is their way of saying con. And I once heard a funny story how on the lower Nass, a woman and her husband were out in a boat, in a dinghy, and her husband saw a fur seal, and he said, "Gosh, we con," or, no, the wife said that to her husband, "Gosh, we con," and her husband got angry at her.
Pardon? You didn't take it as a compliment.
No. But, do any of you know the old word D-E? Women, you call your dad D-E? And in the spa, they call dad D-E or Ha-D-E. So that D-E and Hadi'i are those are the Haida words for father. And then moving on a bit further down to the south, there are people at Kitimat who speak their own language, which they call Ha'isla, 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 and it's a completely separate language. You know, it's not at all in its structure like Somalia.
And you'll tell you if you're wrong.
Okay.
How big a territory do they take in, Bruce?
I couldn't tell you, but I've always found it interesting that they have a name in our language, you know, a name like Gitamat. Yeah. And similarly, another language just south of there, in English is called Bella Bella, but the old people here call those people Wutsdai. And you might think in some ways of Wutsdai or Bala Bala was like a university. They were very well known throughout the region for their halait and secret societies, and men would go there like to study, so forth, to Wutsdai. But these languages are interesting because there's some words, they borrowed words from Somalia, but some words that have been borrowed from them into Somalia are, you know, Kidai, the herring rake, where, you know, in the herring school, you know, the surface of the water, you get them with a rake, a long stick that has the teeth on it, and that's called Kidai. And there's an old village site on the lower Nass River called Lachan Kidai. Lachan Kidai. There. And similarly, this word right here, tapas, which is the bag net that you put under the ice and catch the ulicans. They use over the lower Nass River. And it's interesting that, you know, why would the Niskayak people and other people who speak Slavic borrow this word, you know, from Kitimat, Bella Bella area, where it, you know, it can be analyzed. It has a meaning there, whereas here it's just a name. So those are the languages of the area. I haven't talked about Niskayak right now, or Tsimshian, but some questions. I'd have to ask, I see Mrs. Ryan recognizes the word, tapas. Yeah, tapas. I would say that, yes, these are words that should go into a dictionary because the old people knew them and used them, but they involve technology that people from here are not using anymore, because how many people from here still go down to the Nass in the springtime to fish for ulicans? Mm-hmm. So? Good. Would your husband, say for example, go out with people, you know, with the Nass and so on? Oh, good. Well, I have to eat my words. But if you remember the Tash when you go down there, you can
water the neck is on.
Yeah. It's different from Bana and, you know, the other kinds of nets that are used. I don't know if they still use Gitai or not, but it certainly should be recognized.